Hello students, we are going to start with the next topic, that is next lesson, that is ecosystem. Now, what do you mean by ecosystem? An ecosystem is a community of living organisms, plants, animals, and microbes in conjunction with the non-living components of their environment. Things like air, water, mineral, soil interacting as a system. Now, ecosystem is formed by the interactions between all living and non-living things. The sum of all the biological and non-biological parts of an area that interact to cause plants to grow and decay, soil or sediments to form, and test the chemistry of water to change. So, this is basically the term ecosystem. Now, this term ecosystem was coined by A.G. Tansley in 1935. Interaction, when we talk about living and non-living, as I told you all, it is interaction between biotech and non-biotech components. So it can be an ecosystem can be as large as a desert or as small as a tree. Now, an ecosystem is a unit. Basically, what is an ecosystem? It is a unit because it has boundaries and can be distinguished from its surroundings. And the living and non-living components affect each other through the exchanges of energy, nutrients, and waste. So when I talk about it, look at this picture. It talks about what does the ecosystem consists of: plants, animals, atmosphere. There are decomposers, soil, carbon dioxide. Now, what are the components of ecosystem? Before I come to the components of ecosystem, we will just talk about it. We'll understand the meaning of ecosystem more so in simpler terms. The ecosystem is a core concept in ecology and biology as it serves at a level of biological organization in which organisms interact with the environment. It is a community. Ecosystem is a community of organisms interacting with each other and with the environment such that the energy is exchanged and the system level processes emerge. According to F.R. Fosberg, ecosystem is a functioning interacting system composed of one or more living organisms and their effective environment. Now, when we talk about the structure of ecosystem or the components of ecosystem, that consists of abiotic or non-living components, that is inorganic substances, organic compounds, climate factors. The biotic, we each one of those, we are going to cover it in our own simpler form. Biotic or living components are autotrophs, producers, heterotrophs, consumers, decomposers are saprotrophs. Now, this we know. Abiotic or non-living components, as I said in the previous lesson also, this is a very important term, abiotic, because environmental geography is surrounding behind these two terms. It includes the non-living substances of environment, that is water, soil, air, light, temperature, minerals, and climate. So when I talk about the abiotic factors, basically what I'm talking about climate, when I talk about the climate, here the habitat, when I talk about abiotic components, they include all what is mentioned, sorry. Here, when we talk about it, habitat is the physical environment in which organisms live, including biotic and abiotic components. Now, there are two major habitat types. Students, listen to this carefully. There are two major habitat types, terrestrial and aquatic. The major habitat are able to support ecosystem because they contain the essential abiotic elements. Now, which are the essential elements which you all can see on this slide? That is climate. Now, climate here is the average temperature in a region over a long period of time. It includes, what does climate includes in simple terms? When we talk about climate in geography, you all have learnt that's temperature, wind, precipitation, and sunlight. Now, the climate and the composition help to determine the plant community. Now, you all are there are two common words what you all have heard in your previous classes, that is flora and fauna. When we talk about flora, it is the plant community, and when we talk about fauna, it is the animal community. So it is climate and flora are here to determine the animal community. Next in abiotic, what is important is temperature. Now, how does temperature play an important role? Because it contributes to the erosion and creation of soil and different organisms having different tolerances towards heat and cold. The third abiotic component of the ecosystem is water. We know water is is an important component in erosion and generation of soils. Terrestrial and freshwater environments require animals and plants to conserve or protect water and evolve ways to maintain the water balance or the salt balance. Animals that have secondarily returned to marine environments face water balance challenges since the ocean is now saltier than that what our ancestors had left. Plants can be categorized by their adaptations in water. In science, you all have learned about these topic: mesophytes, xerophytes, hydrophytes. So they are basically mesophytes are adaptation for moderate conditions. The hydrophytes are for the wet environment. Xerophytes or xerophytes are for the dry environments. The fourth one, what we are talking about, fourth abiotic non-living component is sunlight. So this is they are these essential abiotic elements what I am going to throw light upon. Sunlight, what does sunlight do? It intensify affects living things. The daily duration, it also affects the living things. The plants use blue and red light for photosynthesis. We all know of that, we've studied in science. The competition for light is an important factor in many environments. Then angle of incidence of the sun, that is the seasonal changes, also affects climate. And under foliage and underwater habitats have varying levels of these wavelength with red light being there. The fifth abiotic component of the ecosystem is wind. Now, wind contributes to erosion and generation of soils. It affects perceived temperature through evaporation and convection. So, as a abiotic component, what does wind do? It contributes to erosion and generation of soils through evaporation and convection. Temperature is perceived. It affects growth form of plants. It affects the drying out rate of animals and plants, and it affects the rate of photosynthesis. Coming to biotic or living components. When I talk about biotic or living components, I am talking about which factors? Plants, animals, bacteria, and viruses. So, in this also, in biotic or living components, there are autotrophic components, heterotrophic components, producers, consumers, and decomposers. We'll be talking about it one by one. Now, here, the ecosystem structure. Now, when we talk about the ecosystem structure, it consists of the producers, the consumers, and the decomposers. What are the producers? The producers are called the autotrophs. So, the autotrophic components are the producers. So, autotrophic components, they are self-nourishing components in which light fixation or light energy, use of simple inorganic substances, and complex materials manufacturing dominates. When I talk about producers, what am I talking about when I talk about producers? They are the autotrophic organisms. They are the green plants. See, students, the green plants are the only source of living biotic or living component which produces its own food. So chiefly the green plants that utilize the energy, the light energy to manufacture food from simple inorganic substances like water, carbon dioxide and salts. As I said, they are the only organisms that take energy from non-living environment. I repeat, they are the only organisms that take energy from the non-living environment and make it available to all living organisms. In simpler terms, if you think of it, how do they get photosynthesis? They convert the light energy of the sun into chemical energy to form organic compounds that you all have very well learnt about. In the terrestrial ecosystems, if you see in the terrestrial part, you see the major autotrophs are the flowering plants, and in the oceans, they are the microscopic phytoplanktons. Now, if you talk about these phytoplanktons, what are they? They are the tiny plants and are not usually visible unless they are present in great abundance and give water a greenish tinge. In simple terms, when you look at it, producers as autotrophs, they normally capture the sun's energy, powering all other life on Earth. Then, when we talk about the heterotrophs, that is, the consumers must eat to get food. Now, heterotrophic components, they are the other nourishing components and consume products of autotrophs. They attack the dead bodies of the organisms. The interaction, students, the interaction between the autotrophic and the heterotrophic components is a universal feature in the ecosystem. Now, when I talk about consumers or as heterotrophs, what are they? Consumers as heterotrophs. Consumers basically are heterotrophic and organisms, means they are primarily animals and they are either or in the directly or indirectly dependent upon autotrophs for food. What are the autotrophs? They are normal plants that capture the sun's energy. Plants are the autotrophs. The herbivores remains dependent upon green plants for their food and are the primary consumers. A simple example I can give you all is the deer who eats plants. Here, the name given to them is key industry animals to the herbivores because life of other prominent examples of community depends upon these herbivores. Now, the herbivores in turn they are used as food for the primary carnivores or secondary consumers. Water beetles, dragonfly, all of these predaceous insects in pond feed on primary consumers. The secondary consumers or the primary consumers in turn may be utilized as food for the tertiary consumers or the secondary carnivores. Fish. Now, for the best example for tertiary consumers can be fish that eats water beetles and dragonflies are an example, excellent example of tertiary consumers. Some ecosystems may have these top carnivores like lions and vultures, which are not killed or rarely killed and eaten by other animals. Consumers or heterotrophs, they come under the heterotrophic category, that's why I'm repeating it, that feed on both animals and plant animals are called omnivores. So omnivores eat both plant and animals. Then there is parasites. Parasites are the organisms feeding upon the various living tissues of animals and plants. So there are certain parasites which you all are aware of. They are these organisms which feed upon the living tissues of animals and plants. Dead parts of the body of animals and plants are eaten up by scavengers. Scavengers, take for example, eagles and saprophytes. The interaction between organisms and between the biotic and abiotic environment gives a system of checks and balances which results in existence of ecosystem. Now, the third biotic component of the ecosystem is the decomposers under the heterotrophic component. So, students, under the heterotrophic components, what is there? Producers, then there is कंज्यूमर्स एंड डीकम्पोजर्स. सो द लास्ट वन अंडर हेटरोट्रॉफिक इज डीकम्पोजर्स. नाउ डीकम्पोजर्स आर बैक्टीरिया फंगस विच फीड ऑन डेड ऑर्गेनिजम्स फ्रॉम ऑल ट्रॉपिकल लेवल्स रिटर्निंग न्यूट्रिएंट्स टू द सॉइल. लाइक कंज्यूमर्स दीज डीकम्पोजर्स आर हेटरोट्रॉफिक ऑर्गेनिजम्स. दे फीड ऑन वॉट? दे फीड ऑन डेड प्रोटोप्लाज्म ब्रेकिंग डाउन इन टू कॉम्प्लेक्स ऑर्गेनिक कंपोनेंट्स ऑफ सेल्स फ्रॉम डेड प्रोड्यूसर्स एंड कंज्यूमर ऑर्गेनिजम्स ईदर इन टू स्मॉल मॉलिक्यूल्स विच आर यूटिलाइज एज सैफ्रोफाइट्स और इनऑर्गेनिक सब्सटेंसेज दैट कैन बी यूज एज रॉ मटीरियल्स बाय ग्रीन प्लांट्स. Thus, this the continuing functioning of an ecosystem hinges on the activity of decomposers. This category includes bacteria. Now, we'll just have a quick revision of this. Autotrophs, producers. Basically, producers are autotrophs. This has only one category. The organisms which carry out photosynthesis constitute the producers of an ecosystem. Plants is an producer. Because it produces its own food, algae and bacteria. The producers use inorganic substances of the abiotic factors and convert them into organic food materials. As I said, producers use all the abiotic factors, which is water, the salts, carbon dioxide, all of that to make its survival successful and to produce its own food. Consumers, as I said, consumers come under heterotrophs. Consumers are organisms which eat other organisms. All animals are consumers. Now, consumers can be divided into primary consumer, secondary consumer, and tertiary consumer. As I said, that the primary consumers, who are the primary consumers? They are herbivores, which depend upon green plants, are the primary consumers. Now, these primary consumers, which I told you all, they vary in the kind of ecosystem they are in. Then, these herbivorous plants, the deer is used as a food for the lion. That's a primary consumer or secondary consumer. We can say water beetles also feed on these primary consumers. Then, we came on to the secondary consumers, which can be utilized as food for the tertiary consumers. So, the fish that eats water beetles are excellent example of tertiary consumers. The types of heterotrophs, as I covered in this, is saprophytes, as I told you. They are basically, they include heterotrophic plants, fungi, bacteria, which live on dead matter. All this is saprophytes. And they are decomposers also, as I said. Now, these decomposers basically, I'll give you all more information about it in a little more detailing. Herbivores are, how do you categorize them? Plant-eating animals. Carnivores are meat-eating animals. Omnivores, they consume both plants and meat. We human beings are omnivores. Look at this. Pyramid, this slide which shows y'all the bifurcation of what we learned right now. Heterotrophs, autotrophs and all of that. Autotrophs, basically they are the self-nourishing components which fixation of light energy is used for simple organic substances and they manufacture complex material. So, autotrophs are plants. All the plants are autotrophs. Then the next one is heterotrophs, which is the herbivores, plant-eating animals, directly eating plant-eating animals. Then there are primary predators and there are secondary predators. Now, what is heterotrophic components? Again, if we think of it, they are nourishing components and they attack the dead bodies of the organisms. It is the interaction of the autotrophic and heterotrophic components which is a universal feature. Then we learnt about decomposers. Now, little more, decomposers are also known as reducers These are organisms that break up the dead bodies of plants, animals, and their waste products. Now, if you think of fungi and bacteria, how do they work? You have to take it in that context and have to understand this concept of reducer and decomposer. These are organisms that break up the dead bodies of plants, animals, and their waste products. They include fungi and certain bacteria. The enzymes secreted by the fungi and bacteria digest the dead organisms and the debris. Debris is the remains, and the remains go become smaller bits of molecules. After this, what happens once it has gone into their system? These molecules are absorbed by the decomposer or the reducer, and they again give it back to the environment. How they release these molecules to the environment? As chemicals. And when they are released as chemicals to the environment, they are used by the producers. Who are the producers? The plants. So this cycle or this chain moves on. We are going to come across the concept of food chain and food web in our next lecture, which I will be discussing. So I again repeat, this is a very important concept where a reducer and decomposer, there can be a short note or a long question, you all can elaborate. These are some important points which you all can put forth. So it's very easy to understand if you go through these points. Now coming to the last one is the energy flow. Now, when I talk about energy flow, what is energy flow? It is a functional component of ecosystem. It comes under the functional component of ecosystem. What is this? The first one is energy flow, food chain, food webs, nutrient cycles, and the internal regulation are the functional properties of the ecosystem. Now, when we talk about the energy flows through ecosystem in one direction. It is flowing through in one direction, typically from the sun through photosynthetic organisms, that is through plants, including the green plants and algae, through herbivores to carnivores, and finally decomposers. Now, let's throw light on this component of ecosystem, that is energy flow. What is this? All the functions of the ecosystem are in some way related to the growth and regeneration of its plant and species. These interlink processes can be depicted as the various cycles. All these processes depend on energy from sunlight. So the main source of energy is through sunlight. I told you all that plants take light energy and they convert this light energy into chemical energy. So this is one good example. Over here, what we can understand is what happens over here is in this system, such as there is a chain that where it's autotroph to heterotrophs, producers to consumers, herbivore-carnivore relation is there. There is a direction of energy of movement, energy movement through ecosystem. Now in this process, solar energy is converted into chemical energy through photosynthesis by plants. We all are aware of this term photosynthesis. How does photosynthesis take place in plants? It is through the energy, that is the solar energy, which is converted into chemical energy. This also incorporates into protoplasm, a number of inorganic elements and compounds. Now, these green plants, when they are there, they are grazed by whom? They are grazed by heterotrophs. So there is energy flowing from the green plants to the heterotrophs. This means that not only is the chemical energy in the form of carbohydrates, fats, and proteins are transferred into herbivores. So these green plants, which are grazed by certain animals, these carbohydrates, fats, and proteins get transferred into herbivores and a lot of nutrients also. Now, this process continues up to the decomposer level. As it is said, the levels what we learn, students, is producers, then the herbivores, the primary consumers, secondary consumer, then the carnivores, and last is decomposer. So it continues to the last level of decomposer through the carnivores. Now, another feature of this process is that in energy flow, what happens? The energy is trapped by green plants when transferred from one food level of trophic level to an other, which also depicts energy losses at each transfer along the chain. As we are going to learn about this concept, food chain and the trophic levels are all those levels, what primary level and secondary level and all of those levels which I'll be talking about. This, as it gets transferred from one level to the other, the energy is also lost along the chain, which gets passed on from heterotrophs